Good morning. I welcome you as once again we are gathered by God's Holy Spirit to be fed by the bread that endures to eternal life. If you're a first-time worshiper, if you're first-time visiting with us today, we extend warm welcomes. We're glad you're here. We ask a favor. There is a visitor registration card in the little part of the pew rack. Please fill that out and then place it in the offering plate when it comes by. We would appreciate that. I remind everybody there are registration pads. You may register your attendance with those. You may also register your attendance in Holy Communion if you check the little box there, or you can use the communion card in your pew rack too. Speaking of Holy Communion, we will be celebrating that today. We'll do so at the rail, and so you'll come forward two lines in the center. Just fill in at the rail as people leave, and you may fill back in again. And if you come down the center aisle, you can return by the side aisles. As August arrives, so does all of the preparation for fall. It's like we're already starting to gear up. All the school supplies are in the store, you notice. And we need to gear up, too, at the First English Lutheran here. We're looking for Sunday school volunteers. We're looking for confirmation group helpers. We're have to sign up here in August for people who will worship at St. Dismas, so you can't put that off. And right away in September, we'll be serving the banquet. We also need to catch up financially from our summer slump. So we ask that you continue in what way you may help us in all of these areas, and then please do so. Condolences. For the family of Laurie DuBois. Laurie did pass away after her long battle with cancer. And congratulations, the Juffers have welcomed the newest addition to their family, Logan Ann, and all are doing well there. Also, congratulations, Ruben Mathias, Donna Orr, Dolores Ganshaw, all celebrating milestone birthdays. In fact, you can celebrate with Dolores at the coffee time today. Happy birthday, Dennis Jorgensen. Happy anniversary, Mike and Ashley Blish, Elias and Katie Youngquist, and Joe and Kylie Landine, all celebrating anniversaries. Concerning announcements, sometimes I don't always keep informed of what's happening. And again, that situation arose this week that if somebody on Facebook had not told me that the Jeffers had their baby, I wouldn't know, you know. And so one of my summer projects has been I'm going to get on Facebook. As of yet, I haven't done so, I don't know, now that August is coming, it doesn't look like I will get that done, but I'm working at it. And one of the ways in which I'm working at getting on Facebook is until I get signed up, I am treating all the people I meet as if, well, it's Facebook. So I walk down the street every day, and every passerby I come to, I tell them exactly what I've eaten that day. I tell them how I'm feeling at the moment. I tell them what I did the night before. I tell them what I'm going to do this next day and with whom. I show them pictures, too. I show them pictures of my family, of my dog, of me hunting, of me taking things apart in the garage, of me watering the lawn, me standing in front of some landmark, me having lunch, what I'm eating for lunch. I show them pictures of all of this. And I also listen, though, to their conversations. It's not all about me, after all. I listen to their conversations, and I always give them a thumbs up and tell them I like them. And it's all, of course, working just like Facebook, because I already have four people following me. Two are police officers, one's a private investigator, and the other's a psychiatrist. So it's working well. Please stand and greet one another, welcome one another, in the name of our Lord. As we are now prepared for our worship, I invite you to turn to page 21 in the front part of your hymnals, as we begin. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sin to God our Father, imploring Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Most merciful God, you have given your only Son to die for us. Have mercy on us, and for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. By your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, so that by your grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Therefore, by the authority of the Word of God, I declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 210. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, you gave your Son Jesus as the heavenly bread of life. Grant us faith to feast on him in your word and sacraments, that we may be nourished unto life everlasting. This we pray through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our worship continues at the hearing of God's word in Holy Scripture.
The first lesson is from the 16th chapter of Exodus, found on page 58 in the Pew Bible and page 82 in the NIV Children's Bible. God feeds his people with manna, beginning with verse 2. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted, but you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. And in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, 'Come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling.'" While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked toward the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, 'At twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God.'" That evening, quail came and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat." The word of the Lord. The second lesson is from the fourth chapter of Ephesians, found on page 977 in the Pew Bible and page 1298 in the NIV Children's Bible. Paul highlights the gifts of Christ that make us his body. As one body, we are protected from the dangers of our times. Beginning with verse 1. "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, 'When he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men.' What does 'he ascended' mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the singing of the Alleluia verse found on page 25 of the Reclaim Hymnal.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Following the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus is pursued by the crowd, beginning at verse 25. When they found him on the other side of a sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day." The word of our Lord. You, O Christ. You may be seated. I invite the children to come forward for a children's sermon. Okay, we got a story today, And the story is about when Moses had led the people out of slavery in Egypt, and they got to escape the terrible Egyptians. And they escaped out of Egypt to then end up in a wilderness, a desert. And so there they are, following Moses, as Moses leads them by the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. But out in the wilderness, they discover something. They look around and they go, where is the food? I don't see a grocery store. I don't see a McDonald's anywhere. I don't even see a gas station where I can buy a can of pop. Where's the food? The Lord will provide. I don't see any food. There's nothing here. What? Moses, you brought us out here and we're going to die. Oh, I already am feeling weak. I just can't make it. Oh, I don't have enough food. See, we're going to die out here. We were better in Egypt. There, at least, we had food. There, you were slaves. Of course they fed you. They wanted you strong enough to do their work for them. Oh, we're going to die out here. Why did you do this? You horrible man, you brought us out here and to torture us and die of hunger. No, you're mad at me. You're really mad at God. He has brought you out here to save you. No, God's going to kill us. God said he would save you. No, God's going to kill us. Moses talks to God, and God said, tell them I'll take care of them. In the morning, they will wake up, and I will give them bread. God is going to give you bread in the morning. No, we're going to die. There's no food. Well, guess what? They went to sleep, and overnight, God had something like a dew form on the ground. And there it was. And in the morning, as it dried, then they woke up and they looked out on the ground, and guess what they saw? They looked and they go, hey, look, there's stuff on the ground. And they looked at it and they go, manna, which in Hebrew means, what is it? And Moses had to tell them, this is the bread from heaven that God has given you to eat. And they go, And they tried one. Here, you try it. I'm not going to eat it. You eat it. I'm not going to eat it. Hey, let's let the bear eat it. He eats everything. Yeah, okay. And he ate it. Hey, this is good stuff. And the rest of them went, hey, we'll eat it too. And they started eating the manna. And they discovered God is giving us the bread we need. Of course, they did complain after a while. Hey, we're sick and tired of this bread. All we got is bread. When are you going to give us something different? So at night, quails flew into the camp, and then they didn't fly away. And the people could scoop up the quail, and then they could have meat to eat. And they had bread to eat. And all of this was because God had promised that I will feed you, said God. Well, some of them go, we have bread today. What if God doesn't give us bread tomorrow? We would be hungry. I got it. They scooped up extra and they took it and they said, I'm going to save this in my tent. So just in case God doesn't provide daily bread for me tomorrow, I'm going to have bread. So they went to bed, now secure in the thought that they don't have to wait for the manna in the morning. They've saved up enough for themselves. Well, guess what happened the next day when they looked at the manna they had saved? What do you suppose happened? They looked at the manna that they had saved. We don't even need to go outside. We've got our own manna. It's right here, and it's spoiled. It's all rather ucky. It's like moldy and something else. Ooh. God said, I've tested you. I will provide today the bread you need, but I will not give you tomorrow's bread today. You're going to have to depend upon me every day to give it to you. So you'll have to have faith to wake up that morning and know the Lord has provided the food we need. And this is the story of how God provided for his people, the Israelites in the wilderness, their daily bread. So, to help you remember this, guess what I have for you? Some daily bread, like sort of like the manna I was using in the story. So each of you can have a sack of manna that you've in. And guess what? It's actually edible. In fact, you'll find it tastes just like Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Okay? So thanks for coming up. Share it with somebody else. Okay. You're welcome.
Thank you. Grace, mercy, peace be unto you from God our Father, from our Lord, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. Has this ever occurred in your life? Wake up, it's time to go to worship. Wake up, it's time to go to worship. Do I have to? Yes, you get to. I don't want to. Well, why not? It's boring. No, it's not. It's worship. It's just a bunch of words, yada, 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 yada. It's boring. Of course it's a bunch of words. It's worship. Well, couldn't they add some action in there, some excitement, maybe an explosion every now and then? Why can't they stir things up instead of all the yada, 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 yada? Enough. Get up. Give me one good reason why I should. I don't want to go if it's going to bore me out of my mind. Okay. Reason one, you are part of this family, and this family goes to worship. Reason two, you're the pastor. Maybe except for that last sentence, it has sounded familiar somewhere in your experience. This is because to our human ears and eyes, to our old sinful self, worship is boring. It's mostly just a bunch of words said or sung, or heard. It doesn't seem to be very active and get anything done. I know there are times when the children's sermon is the highlight of the worship service, especially if you have an extra rambunctious child that day. At least something is happening. You get to watch a kid, swing from the communion rail or something, and you get to watch the pastor try to improvise and all this. I mean, there's at least some action. So as judged by our human mind, by our sinful nature, worship is just a boring waste of time that's filled with a lot of talk. And you know what the human view of talk is. Talk is cheap. It's easy to talk the talk, but can you walk the walk? Why can't there be more walking and doing in worship? Why don't we just cancel worship? Why don't we all go out and do random acts of kindness? At least it would eliminate all this boring words, and talking, yada, yada. See, according to our human analysis, worship as we conduct it, as we have conducted it for centuries, is not only boring, it's ineffective. What good is getting done? Does your sacrificial offering of yourselves upon the pew every Sunday somehow earn you any credits? We'd like to think so. We'd like to think that, well, you sit in a pew and you suffer for that hour. At least you're earning some extra credits and good luck so that you now will have better luck than the people who are out enjoying themselves, not bored, out at the lake or the golf course. But does this ever prove true? Are there temporal benefits from sitting and listening to all the words? It was this human instinctual desire for temporal benefits that actually I can see and taste and touch, that Jesus has to contend with in John 6. He's just fed 5,000 with the 5 barley loaves and the 2 fish. Now that crowd pursues him. because they had just eaten their fill of free food. The people see, ooh, there's some tangible benefit for hanging around this Jesus guy. Lower grocery bills. But this instinctual human desire for free food is why Jesus had to say, do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. John 6:27. The response of the crowd is what you would predict, at least from a bunch of religious people. Okay, we got it. So what must we do to be doing the works of God? This is religious principle number one, by the way. We do, and then God will give. So we want eternal life, and therefore, what do we have to do? Which is why I've said repeatedly, Christianity is not a religion. And again, this is pointed out when Jesus gives his answer to their religious question, what do we got to do, what do we got to do, in order to get all these good benefits, free food and all this. Jesus' response is, this is the work of God. We were just asking, what do we have to do to be doing the works of God? And you come back and go, this is the work of God. What type of answer is that? Is he changing the subject matter? No, but he's changing the subject of the sentence. In their sentence, it's all about them. It's me, myself, and I. What do I have to do? Jesus goes, this is what God has done. This is the work of God. What is the work of God? The one who's standing right in front of them, talking to them, is the work of God. This is the one whom God has sent into this world to be his word, his living word. This is all throughout John. I mean, that's why John begins his gospel with that prologue. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is the Word of God, Jesus. He's standing right in front of them, talking to them, and now he goes, this is the work of God, that you believe in the one whom he has sent. The feeding that is taking place is when Jesus talks to them. When he is speaking to them, he is feeding them the bread of life, which is his very self. They, of course, are still stuck on the sign they received of these 5,000 getting fed with five little barley loaves, two fish. But Jesus keeps talking and preaching to them. He doesn't give them any more food. He doesn't give them any more bread. Eventually, and it would be nice if we had time, I read a little past this cutoff anyway, because I don't think next 2 weeks you'll get it. But I could have read the entire sixth chapter, because by the end of it, Jesus preaches this crowd that is 5,000 plus, he preaches them back down to 12. They all leave, because they aren't getting what they want. All they're getting is a bunch of yada, yada, and the stuff they're hearing they don't like. Like they're going to be eating his body and drinking his blood. That's later in the chapter. You see, Jesus is not ushering in a new religion. He's not telling people how it is that you're going to fill yourselves up. That, by the way, when you start hearing that, you know, this is religion. When somebody's going, here's how you fill yourself up, whether it be, you know, spiritually getting filled, or whether it will be filling your wallet and all these stuff. That's, you know what you're getting when you hear that. Jesus is not saying, be empowered in all of this. Jesus is, in fact, turning it all around, and he's saying, this is the work of God. Me, says Jesus, that I will do, and you will believe in me. How do we believe in Jesus? Well, they're going, well, we might believe in you, Jesus, But you remember Moses fed those people in the wilderness, all this manna? They're back to the free food, by the way. So we need some signs like that again. When you get stuck on this stuff, you don't get off it. So they're back at it again. Okay, we'll believe in you, but give us some more stuff. We need more bread. No, says Jesus, you're not getting the signs because they aren't meaning anything to you. By the way, in John's gospel, he always talks of the miracles as signs. Interesting language there. He says these are signs. The first sign of the Cana at wedding where he changes the water to wine. Now the sign of bread. Because you have to understand, what is a sign? If you had the sign that said, I bring the sign that says Linux. Is this Linux? No, it's a sign. It tells you where Linux begins and ends. The sign is always pointing, saying, here is something, but it's not it. Jesus is going, forget the signs. They're supposed to be directing to me. I'm it. The crowd doesn't hear it. They don't hear what Jesus is giving them, which is himself to be the bread of life that has come down from heaven to give eternal life. They're still going, where's the stuff? Give us the stuff. We don't have any stuff. It gets rather boring. Jesus just stands there and talks about yada yada, bread of life, and they don't get anything. To our human sinful eyes and ears, we want the signs. We want the stuff that's always flashy and attractive, and we desire it. Which is why when you come to worship, you don't get any stuff. Okay, well, the kids got cereal. But you don't really get any stuff. You don't get any flashy, here it is. You don't even really get anything. You're going, well, where's the practicality? Give me 12 steps to make sure I'm always going to have bread to eat. No. What you get is the Word of God. The Word of God that does, and what he does is by saying it. God says, God does. So you hear God speak to you through his words of Scripture, through the words of a preacher, to tell you Jesus is the bread of life. And that in him you have life eternal. It's done. It's given. As you hear it and believe it, so it is. Shouldn't there be something more spectacular? An explosion? No. God works by his word. And so you come to worship. And you get the boring yada, 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 words. No. You come to worship and you get God giving his very presence to you in the way that he gives everything, by speaking it unto you as a promise to be heard, and in hearing to be grasped, and in grasping it is yours. The faith is what grasps it. Jesus has come. Jesus, the Word of God, has come to speak unto you words of eternal life, and to speak unto you that you have eternal life in him, the Word of God. It is given. It is received by ears of faith. This is the bread that you will live on all your life, to eternal life. And if at any time you're going, I don't know, that's why you keep coming back, to hear again the promise which gives you the bread of life It is our life that we live with daily. Amen. Our worship continues with the offering. It's no sacrifice of ourself in order to get something back. Our offering is that, well, we have, and therefore we share. And we share a portion of what the Lord has given us because we want to help our neighbors. We want our neighbors, we want everyone to be able to hear this word of life. So our worship continues with our offering. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, for all people according to their needs. Thanks be to you, O God and Father of us all, for giving us the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. By his self-offering on the cross for us, satisfy our hunger and thirst for your salvation. Lord, in your mercy. United in the one body by the one Spirit, we rejoice in the one hope, one faith, one baptism into Christ. Help us grow deeper in our unity with you and with each other, leading a life worthy of the calling by which we have been called. Lord, in your mercy. Bless all your chosen children in their ministry. Cause them to be faithful and wise stewards of your church and to preach your word in its purity. Lord, in your mercy. Inspire the leaders of the world to do justice, to love mercy, to walk humbly with you. Be with all people, that they may live together in harmony in their neighborhoods and communities. Lord, in your mercy. Even as you fill our souls with living bread, we thank you that you open wide your hand and satisfy the needs of every living creature. Come to the aid of all who long for daily bread and provide for their needs that they may serve you in health and strength. Inspire us to come to their aid and give us the spirit of self-control so that we may use your gifts of food and drink for your glory and not in self-indulgence. Lord, in your mercy. Hear the cries of all who suffer any need of body, mind, and spirit. Visit them in their distress. Uphold all those who fall. Lift up those who are bowed down. Come to the aid of those we name before you now. Family of Laurie DuBois, those suffering from the wildfires out west, those who have suffered loss in this life. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for the blessings of life in this creation, for the many years you have blessed to Reuben and Dolores and Donna and Dennis. We thank you for the new beginning that you have gifted in Logan Ann. For this, we turn to you and realize you are the Lord of life. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks
for those who have died in the faith, for our departed loved ones. Continue to fill us with your loving bread until the day when we join with them in the feast which is to come. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our worship continues with the preface on page 33 in your blue hymnals. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, our Lord and Savior, who ascending above the heavens and sitting at your right hand, poured out the Holy Spirit as he promised upon the chosen disciples, causing the whole earth to rejoice. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is now ready for us to come and receive bread and wine, but also in with and under the bread and the wine is the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We believe that we receive what is promised, the forgiveness of our sins. As you are baptized, as you have been instructed to see Christ present in this sacrament, we invite you to come forward and receive. If you care not to receive, you may receive a blessing. We'll do so. All is now ready. Come forward. On the night in which our Lord is betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." You may kneel as you wish.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able for the blessing and benediction. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which you have just received, may it strengthen you, may it preserve you in faith. Amen. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this, your salutary gift. We ask it in your blessing that you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 208. You may be seated.